Good evening. Oh, I thought I was going to get a few minutes of Gary's time, but it's reset. So I'm going to take a little bit of a step back and spend a little bit of time talking about partisan gerrymandering from the perspective that I know, which is a legal perspective, rather than in social scientific terms. And I want to say a little bit about why this issue has been such a vexing issue, I think more vexing than it might appear in its face. And I'll say that without disagreeing with anything that Gary just said about partisan symmetry or about the ability to measure outliers. So I'm going to just start with some remarks about the case law of the Supreme Court in this area, some of which has already been previewed, before discussing some of the obstacles to crystal clear thinking in the area of partisan gerrymandering. So the court first addressed the constitutionality of partisan gerrymandering in a 1986 case called Davis versus Vandemer. That was a case involving redistricting following the 1980 census in the Indiana state legislature. And in that case, in the plurality opinion there, Justice White said that a party can prevail in a claim of partisan gerrymandering by showing two things, essentially. One is intent, right? So intentional discrimination against an identifiable political group, and, quote, an actual effect on that group. So this is a standard kind of discrimination test. You have to show both intent and effect. In this case, Justice White said, effect meant, quote, evidence of continued frustration of the will of a majority of the voters, or effective denial to a minority of voters a fair chance to influence the political process. All right, so you have to give a fair chance to influence the political process. And that standard was essentially borrowed from racial vote dilution cases. You could show that a minority group's right to vote was being diluted if you can show both intent and success in diluting the vote. So in some sense, partisan gerrymandering has long been compared to race-based gerrymandering, or racial vote dilution in that case. But the difficulty of establishing a partisan gerrymander versus racial vote dilution is in some sense reversed, right? So the intent prong, showing intent an intentional gerrymander, tends to be quite easy in the case of partisan gerrymandering, more difficult in the case of racial vote dilution. The effect prong, so intent easier in the context of partisan gerrymandering than racial gerrymandering. With respect to effect, it's kind of reversed, right? So it's easier to show that a racial minority group has been denied its opportunity to influence the political process than a political group like the Democrats or the Republicans. A racial minority group is often numerically smaller than voters from one of the major political parties, and so it's easier to frustrate a racial minority group's ability to influence the political process in a sustained way. Maybe more importantly, whether someone is a member of a racial minority group is a fixed characteristic in a way that is not true of whether someone's a Democrat or a Republican, right? Whether Democrats or Republicans have been denied effective participation in the political process interacts in complex ways with the substantive issues that they tend to support or not to support. So the Supreme Court never held, it never justiciated the Davis versus Vandemer standard. Indeed, in a 2004 case, Veith versus Jubilier, four members of the court were willing to say that there's no judicially manageable standard. Justice Kennedy, in that case, of course, agreed that there was no clear standard for declaring a violation in Pennsylvania in that case, but he refused to say that a standard might not emerge or develop at some point in the future. The Wisconsin case that was argued last month, Gill versus Whitford, is an effort to revisit that question. And as we've already discussed, the three-judge district court there over a dissent relied in part on this so-called efficiency gap that Moon Dukin will tell us more about in a moment. Now, interestingly, it appeared that every member of the court in the Pennsylvania case conceded that partisan gerrymandering was inconsistent with democracy. So if there's so much agreement about the undemocratic nature of partisan gerrymandering, why is it that the court has not played an especially meaningful role so far? So I'm going to list very quickly what I'll say is six obstacles, and I'll just discuss each very, very briefly. In sum, they're first, constitutional design. Second, one person, one vote. Third, race. Fourth, what one might call a baseline problem. Fifth, geography, and sixth, remedial concerns. So first, on constitutional design, right? The Constitution does not specify any particular democratic arrangement, nor does it, by its terms, exclude political influence over the structure of the electoral process. Right? The manner of conducting elections for Congress, for example, is granted in the first instance to state legislatures. No explicit constitutional guidance over how to do that, whether to have districts at all, whether to represent individuals or groups or interests, how to count votes, how to declare winners, whether to have secret ballots or voice voting, how to structure political primaries or ballot access. These are all controlled by statute. They're not controlled by constitutional standard. And so the constitutional text just doesn't get us very far in this area. Second, one person, one vote, right, which has already been mentioned, does not only not prevent gerrymandering, but it indeed facilitates gerrymandering insofar as because of one person, one vote, every 10 years at a minimum, there has to be a redistricting, and that is going to be an invitation to mischief on the part of partisan redistrictors. Third, there's an interdependent relationship between race-based and partisan-based redistricting. Right? Under the Voting Rights Act, states are, under certain circumstances, required to create majority-minority districts. Many minority groups, especially African Americans, vote overwhelmingly in favor of one party. Right? And so if you are required, to some degree, to stuff all the supporters of a large number of supporters of a single party into one district, that's a pretty effective means of engaging in partisan gerrymandering. And so there's a degree to which the Voting Rights Act, as interpreted by the court, actually requires a partisan imbalanced map that has to be corrected in some way. Fourth, what some might call a baseline problem. Should an ideal map be based on creating competitive districts? Should its overriding goal be to treat the parties the same, so partisan symmetry of some kind? Should it be focused on creating a degree of political stability, which might be in tension with competition and with treating parties the same? Should it aim for proportional representation? Right? These are all choices that might be in some tension with each other. And note, by the way, that a perfectly competitive map would make proportional representation extremely difficult, because if you have a wave election, that would cause a small change in support to lead to a big change in the division of seats. Fifth, voters are not randomly distributed as to party, right? Democrats tend to cluster in cities. So if you're going to use so-called neutral criteria, such as maintaining county or other municipal boundaries, the natural tendency is going to be, to some degree, to pack Democrats and put them at a disadvantage on a statewide map. And so you need a theory that tells you whether and to what degree that's acceptable or not. Finally, the only way to remove politics entirely out of the process is to remove politicians out of the process. And so unless the court is prepared to do that by, for example, requiring an independent commission, and that would be contrary to basically all of American history, then the court needs to tolerate a certain degree of political control. And once you say that some political control is allowed, the nature of the problem ends up becoming a difference of degree rather than a difference in kind, and courts get very nervous about weighing in on questions of degree. All right, so in sum, significant traction through the courts is going to be an uphill climb, not to say that it's impossible, but regardless of what the court says in Gill versus Whitford, there are going to be a number of obstacles to doing this in a very transparent way. Thanks.